tell the man is right. Sleeping with somebody without begging for hand in marriage, what is right about it? What if the first person is having HIV and you go on and you're infected with that, then what's right about that? Come on. See, it's time we know the truth. Let's speak reality to ourselves. Amen. And any girl that a man picks so cheaply, if a man does not go to prostrate for your parents or beg your hand in marriage, he will handle you like a sheep lady. Take it or leave it. Because so easy, probably some of you will just leave your mother's house and say, "Mommy, I'm tired of this country. I am 16. And you pack and go. And you go to the man's house, and the man start boxing you like Mike Tyson. And you say, "My mommy, come on, you want it? Did your mommy send you to Mike Tyson?" So we have to look at what the foundation at first. Amen. Now, let's not talk of people that are married without having sexual intercourse. Now you know the first cause. So, and for some, another cause people will receive, I will tell you. Some men, you see yourself as Maradona. You're a good boy, a footballer, a player. Now, after you alone, you deserve 10 women. And at the end of the day, you said, you pray that God should give you a virgin. May the Lord give you one then. Now, you alone, after doing that with 10 women and promising them, "I am for you," don't you know there's a covenant in you having sex with them? And at the end of the day, you married and you say there's one witch, is your mother, is your grand, is your in-law that is the witch. It's not your in-law, you are the social. Because how do you think those women you cheated and told you are going to marry? Some of you even go to the extent of duping those ladies. You take their money, and at the end of the day, some people will still dupe them, molest them, drop them in there, just tell them, "You know what? I was watching the film, somebody just called a woman and said, 'Do you know what? I'm just calling you to tell you that I deleted your love from my heart now.'" Just like that. When is not a computer, command language, delete. Not even backspace. And the girl was, "Ah, don't do that to me." No, she did that to herself. Now, the second thing is, sincere sister, Christian sister, born again and Holy Ghost brother. Now, this sister has kept herself as a virgin all this while. And praying God, "Show me the right man, show me the right man." Eventually, he met a brother in the church as well that is going, "Shakalaba, shakalaba." And the brother looks so spiritual. Probably the sister is dark in complexion, not too tall, of average height. And the brother speaking in tongues is looking for, in his mind, he's looking for a lady that is tall, light in complexion, and very balanced, you know. And at the end of the day, this sister, the brother has proposed to the sister. "Sister, you know what? The Lord told me, I saw myself by the well. And when I want to fall into the well, now you just hold my leg." I said, "Who is that that hold my leg?" "Ah, it is you. That means God says we should be together." And the sister will now go down the next day. "I also dreamt, I saw myself in the pit, and I was looking, I was chasing her, and I just saw your hand pick me up." And you said, "Two, it is now a balanced equation." At the end of the day, this brother will now go to this and say, "You know what? There's probably in the course of courtship, you are telling him, 'Don't touch me, don't touch me.' You say, 'Let's be in the room together.' You say, 'Okay, I don't want sex before the marriage.' If you allow him to just molest you and say, 'God will forgive,' at the end of the day, he's going to marry you now. If he molest you and come back to tell you, 'Sorry, something changed,' at the end of the day, the sister is the loser. Mind you, the brother will not go scot-free. Amen. So that is the second area of it. And the third aspect of it is that the brother and the sister might be born again. They didn't have sex before marriage. Now they are into it. But they didn't pray very well. When I say they didn't pray very well, you must know everything that will stand as barrier when you marry somebody. I.e., you want to marry somebody, you don't know who the mother of the person is, you don't know the parent of the person, you don't know what family he comes from. Probably in that family, their men often die before age 40. I know the family that all their men, they don't grow up beyond 40 years. Amen. So, probably in that family, There are women do not always have the fruit of womb. They always wait for 10, 15 years. You don't investigate that. Or probably in that family, none of them has ever married one wife. Or in that family, they always divorce a wife to marry another one. So, or probably you now saw a man there that is telling you he looks young. And he's telling you he came from Nigeria, he's 35 or 40 years old. And he tells you he's single, he's even a virgin. And you to say, Azakan, look at that man, he looks like he's saved. Probably the man already has 10 children at home from three different women. And you to say, for very tough I was, you be the one to clothe him, buy him suit, dress him up. You say, I have met my honey. And to that Jesus part, I am in love. You know, you have made me fall in love. Better fall in love over. So it is very, very important that you seek pastoral counsel. Amen. Somebody brought someone to me, and I told the person, I said, see, do you know this brother very well? He said, we've been together for 2 years. So, brother, do you know this sister? He said, yes, I know. I said, brother, did you tell the sister that you've been married twice? He looked at me and said, don't say, you are married twice. He said, yes. He said, and in those two marriages, you have one different child. One for one first woman, one for another child, another woman. He said, no, really. I said, no, it is really. The first one is a boy, the second one is a girl. And the first one you married her in 2005. The marriage broke up in 2007. And specifically in March 2007, you married the second one. The man said, I said, sister, have you seen your true love? Sister said, Pastor, sorry, I have to go now. Can we go now? I said, it's up to you. You can stay here. Even if you want to sleep, I'll give you bed. Now, according to them, their plan was that in 3 months' time, they'll be wedding. You want to marry somebody that already had two children for two different women who has not confessed to you 3 months before the wedding? And are you sure that marriage is going to be fruitful? Amen. I need questions. Two questions from people that I'll respect. Now, the other thing that can affect marriages not to work is when parents of either party has entered into a covenant. Amen. I dealt with the case. That is, I told the sister said, for some reason, her mother-in-law doesn't want her to marry her son. And her mother-in-law does not want her to marry the boy. So I told her, the reason for that is that your mother-in-law is a witch. Your mother is a witch as well. So your mother-in-law knows that if you marry that son of his, he knows your mom. That you at the point they needed somebody to put down. They want to use someone's blood or someone's life. They want to give a life. Mostly women that are witches, if they want to give a life, they will rather go for their son-in-law rather than their own daughter or their son. They will go for in-law first because they say, it's part of my child now. So they will leave that soul instead of their own soul. So for that reason, mothers that are witches would like to protect their children by not allowing them to go and marry from a witch. Does that make sense? Contrary to that, some of them will be close friends and they will vow that any child I marry, I will give my daughter to you, your own son. But we will protect them and work together as a force. That's contrary to that in some cases. Now, if you want to marry, you must know the kind of person your mother-in-law is spiritually. You must find out who your mother-in-law is. You must find out the spiritual personality of your father-in-law. If your father-in-law is someone that belongs to a cultic group, and you want to marry a daughter, and you don't know what he has done to do, that's not to tell you not to marry the person again, but you know you have a battle to fight before you marry. If you get to know before you marry that your mother-in-law is a witch, all you need to do is to consult a prayerist, a man of God that can pray through with you. So that any covenant the woman has made over her child will be destroyed. The woman will not die, but the covenant she has made over that daughter of us, which belongs to you as a wife, will then be broken and you can marry the woman without any negative covenant. If the father has all, the prayer will be emphasized on breaking covenant the father has made on the son or the daughter. Does that make any sense? And after the covenant has been broken, you know for the rest of your life, you will pray like no man's business. If they pray and they pray the covenant, I think you are now free. to go ahead, not just like that, you have to be prayerful also. Does that make any sense? So, any question? Just one or two questions are welcome. Then we can close this chapter. If there's no question, let us bow down our heads in prayer. I believe you've learned something from today. If you've learned something, let's give it to Jesus. Now, there's something I did not remember to tell you, which is also vital, and that's the area of if you are married to somebody and eventually you find to know that the person is not the right man for you, what should you do? It's actually in the Bible.